dead. Oh no, here we go. Worst case scenario, at least that's what my feelings tell me. What's real, what's meant to steal? Everything I feel is a little overwhelming. Pause, take a breath, lift my head. Oh, the air goes clear like somebody turned on the lights. Oh, I see. Singing, it's gonna be alright.
take a trophy to make you better. I've never been more in love than I am now. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Spring Hills. Happy Easter.
Hey, happy Easter. What's up, Spring Hills? How are you?
My name is Catherine.
My name's Zach. We're part of the Next Gen staff here.
So babies through 25-year-olds, those are our people. They're who we hang out with all week, on the weekends. And with that, if you have a kid with you in here, babies through fifth grade, we've got a program happening right now for you.
Yes, babies through fifth grade. If you want your kids to have an amazing Easter program, we would love to invite you. Right outside these doors here, there's the birth through threes. Three-year-olds, and then elementary is over in a different wing, but we'd love to have you drop your kids off if you'd like, or even if you just want to get rid of them for an hour.
Little hour break for you. We've got an awesome team that would love to hang out with your kids. We've got a great program for them. Yeah. And then during the week, we have programs for our junior high on Tuesday nights.
Tuesday nights, and Wednesday night is our young adults. Thursday night is high school. We've got programs for every age and stage here, so wherever you're at Spring Hills, you are welcome here. We're so glad you're with us. This service is going to be about 60 minutes, and Kath and I are going to be talking for about 45 of those minutes.
So you ready to hang out?
We're going to get real comfortable.
Just kidding. We won't do that to you. Just the students. Just the students.
It's great.
Like he said, we're going to be together for about an hour. And then after the service, we've got pancakes. We've got sausage. So stick around. And then we have the most epic egg hunt for the kids.
So good. We've got an Easter egg hunt out there. This year, I'm competing with the four-year-olds, okay?
So if you got a four-year-old,
watch out.
With the four-year-olds.
I might take them out. I really want the golden eggs this year. but if you want to go out there, it's going to be an amazing time with the kids. We've got a pancake breakfast over here. We're going to be doing a pancake eating contest that Pastor Brett has never lost. And he's ready to get.
Today's the day. Today's the day.
He said he's going for 30 pancakes this year.
We also have a gift for you guys. So after the service, as you're exiting, we've got a team that's going to be passing out a book called The Case for Easter.
Yeah, and The Case for Easter is written by Lee Strobel, who was a former atheist. He came to know Christ, and he's putting the proof of the resurrection. So if you've ever wondered, like, man, why do Christians believe what they believe? I don't understand why there's any evidence for this. There is evidence for Christianity. There's historical evidence and scientific evidence that Jesus really was who he said he was, and then he rose again from the dead.
Yeah, so grab a book on your way out.
Yeah, grab
a book. Great.
We're so excited you're here.
We are. Yeah. We're so, like, Easter is the best weekend to celebrate together, right? We've got Jesus' resurrection. We've got a ton of fun. But we have a lot of things that we do here at Spring Hills. We like to have a good time around here. So to learn more, go ahead and check out the Spring Hills News.
Happy Easter. Jesus is alive. My name is Jenna, and we're so glad that you could be here to celebrate with us. We want to invite you back this Wednesday for an experience we like to call First Wednesday. The first Wednesday of every month, we come together for a powerful service with worship, a message, and communion. This Wednesday, Pastor Brett will be bringing us a message called No Fear. Maybe you're wrestling with fear right now. There is hope for you this Wednesday. We'll be having pizza together on the patio around 6:30, and then service will start right after at 7 p.m. Hey parents, we want to invite your kids to join us this summer for Adventure Week. Your kids will have the opportunity to make lasting memories, have a ton of fun, and learn all about God's love for them. Adventure Week is a high-energy, half-day camp, and we have 3 weeks for you to choose from. Pick your week in June and get registered, as space is limited. Registration is on sale this weekend, but prices will increase on Monday. So head to springhills.org/adventureweek to register your camper for the best week of the summer. Last fall, our church took a huge step of faith and launched the Only God Initiative. Hundreds of us are giving to see God work through this movement. This weekend, we released the first issue of the Only God magazine. This spring issue includes an article about our architect, a financial update, encouraging stories of faith, the project timeline for 2024, ways for you to join the journey, and more. You can pick up a copy of the Only God magazine on the patio or in the lobby and be encouraged today. We'd love to have you join us next weekend as we launch our new sermon series, After the Grave. This series will be taken from 1 Corinthians 15 and is applicable to all of us. If you've ever asked the questions, what's next, or what does Jesus' resurrection mean for me, then this series will be perfect for you. We're so glad that you came to church today. Happy Easter, and welcome to Spring Hills.
believe in the name of Jesus Christ. Christ the Son, all praise to the Holy Spirit, our God has overcome, the King who was and is and evermore will be, in Jesus' mighty name I believe. I believe, I that Jesus Christ has won. So
Thank you. For your love, for the sacrifice that you made by sending your son to die for us and then conquering death so we can be alive in you, God. We pray that you bless this morning. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, welcome again. It's great to see you. Go ahead and take a seat, and as you do that, check out the screens.
I saw Jesus crucified. I spoke to him as he died. I saw him in his struggle. I watched as he breathed his last breath, and when he stopped breathing, I lost my breath too. The one who walked on water is no more. The one who fed 5,000 is now food for the worms. And if he has been defeated, what does that mean for me? I thought that he would be the king who would rise up and rule our nation. I thought that we were the ones to bring truth and revelation, but it turns out we were wrong. I mean, maybe we imagined this all along. As I watched his body taken down from the cross, I saw my friend was gone. And he was the one who found me. How could this be? He must have gone before his time. It must have been too soon. It must have been an illusion or a dream. He can't be in a tomb. I can't come to grips with the thought that the man who claimed to be I am was slain by the hands of men. And then she burst through the door. Our friend Mary, she said someone had taken the body of the Lord. So we ran to the tomb, only to find an empty room, and the stone was rolled away. I looked on the floor and I saw his clothes, and that's when I knew he rose. Jesus is alive. He did walk on water. He did feed the 5,000. He did raise Lazarus from the dead and heal thousands. He did make the wine. He did talk to God. He did pray for those who put him on the cross, and he raised back to life. Just like Lazarus, except for he would never die again. Jesus took death. Nails in his hands, nails in his feet, a crown of thorns on his head for you. He laid his life down and he took it back again. Jesus is alive.
Oh, again, everybody, and happy Easter. Good to see you. All right. Well, I'm excited to bring an encouraging message to you today. I mean, how could it not be encouraging? Jesus rose from the dead. I mean, it doesn't get any better than that. So, yeah, let me encourage you with that. I was thinking back before I came out here, just about what the resurrection has accomplished, which is so amazing. I mean, it's the great enemy that we all have to deal with is not the Republicans or Democrats, all right? I mean, it's the greatest enemy in your life is not like how to raise your kids and how to get through difficult seasons in your life. Those things are real. The greatest enemy, ladies and gentlemen, is death itself. You know, a lot of times we don't think about it. You know, just having lost my brother with ALS recently over the last couple of weeks, having lost my twin brother. Some of you didn't know I had a twin brother. He wasn't as good looking as me. We were fraternal twins, not identical twins. He wasn't as athletic as me, but that's another story. All right, so. But I lost my twin brother. Then both my twin brother, knew the Lord, and so I have that hope of eternal life. And my dad had passed away, and my stepmom. What I'm telling you is death is the ultimate enemy. You can't beat it, all right? Yeah, you just can't. Some of you, you're like, I'm young. Yeah, I don't need to hear of this, Pastor. Oh, yeah, you do, because it's inevitable. I don't need to prepare for that yet, you know, like, why should I prepare for my death now? Because you could drive out of here and be, you know, hit by a semi-truck. I mean, you just don't know. Am I right? Just read, you know, the stories. If you're not ready to face death, you're not ready to live. You're going to die. It's an encouraging message, isn't it? I'm kind of like, I'm into it. I can tell you how to do that. Jesus Christ rose from the dead. If you put your faith and your trust in him, the scripture promises that you'll be forgiven of your sins and given the gift of eternal life. In other words, the enemy death that nobody can conquer, you can conquer it in Christ. Christ gives you the victory even over death. And then you can live. Then you can have hope. I mean, real hope, substantial hope. Because Christ rose from the dead, you're in him, you know him, you too will conquer death. I mean, what brings death, everybody? It's sin. And a little Bible lesson. God created the heavens and the earth. God created this earth. Beautiful, perfect, created Adam in his own image, created Eve, taken from the rib of Adam, lived in the Garden of Eden, perfect, ideal in every way. And then the devil tempted them to sin against God. God had promised, you know, told them, every tree from the garden you can eat, you know, enjoy the Garden of Eden, except for the tree in the middle of the garden. Don't touch it, lest you die. And Eve went over and started, you know, looking at that tree they weren't supposed to eat from, and she got tempted, and it was like, wow, why can't we have that? Why did God forbid us to eat from the tree in the middle of the garden? And so she took it, and she ate, gave it to her husband who was with her, and he ate, and they disobeyed God, which is the definition of what sin is. It's disobeying what God has set forth as right and good and just. And anyway, they sinned, and realized they were naked, the scripture says, and so they sewed up fig leaves and covered themselves. And all of a sudden, shame enters the world right there. Sin, shame, embarrassment. Adam hears the sound of God in the garden. He's afraid. He wasn't afraid before sin entered the world. He wasn't hiding from God before he disobeyed God. There was no covering up. But now they're hiding from God. God asked Adam, did you eat from the tree that I told you not to eat from? Will you confess your sins right now? I know, it's one of the things we all need to realize that's part of being saved, is confessing your sins. Adam, did you eat from the tree? And what did he say? A lot of you know. That woman you gave me. That woman. And ever since, we've been blaming other people for our sins. Explaining it away, you know. Very sophisticated. I got a disease. My friends, they're bad, and I fell into it. And I mean, we just got an excuse for our sin before God, all the way back to Adam. Scripture says if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us. So it's no longer, you know, the devil made me do it. She made me do it. He made me do it. My dysfunctional family made me do it. The liquor store down the street made me do it. No, you sinned against God, whatever. Christ came to undo all that, to forgive sin. Part of what happened to Adam and Eve, what happened to Adam and Eve? They died. God told them, the day that you eat from the tree that I told you not to eat from, you shall die. We're in Adam, the scripture says. Adam was our representative head. We're in Adam. We're born with a sin nature. We're born in sin. And that sin needs to be forgiven for eternal life. But being born in Adam, guess what happens to us? We're all dying, and we will all die because we are all in Adam who sinned and faced the consequences. The soul that sins shall die. What are we going to do? What are we going to do? Oh, some people think, oh, look, AI will figure this out. Give artificial intelligence a chance. They'll figure out this death gene. You know? Somebody will come up with something, right? I mean, we'll just research this thing, and we may all die in the process, but somebody will figure it out. Experiment. There is no death. It gets the final word. But Christ, when he rose from the dead, conquered it. How did he conquer it? He paid for sin. He's the Son of God. He defeated the devil, who's been behind the scenes, everybody. Ever since the garden, he's been behind the scenes. That's why you see so much evil. Oh, may God open our eyes to understand that behind the evil of our culture and the beliefs of our culture and the movements of our culture is the devil who was in the garden many years ago. He's still around. He's still doing his own thing. He's still telling you, you don't need God. And when God prohibits something, it's because you're missing out. So go ahead. Do what you want. You know, God, you got a better plan than God's plan. That's always the devil's ways. But when Christ died on the cross, he defeated the devil. What did the devil have? The devil had this world. The devil, you know, had a grip on it. Jesus defeated the devil at the cross. And he also defeated the results of sin, which is death. How do you get in on that? You get in on that through believing in what Jesus did for you on the cross. And you confess your sin. No blaming, no shifting. You confess your sin. Jesus and resurrection. Jesus appears to the disciples in Luke 24 and verse 35. It says, then they told what had happened on the road and how he was known to them in the breaking of bread. This is the two that were on the road to Emmaus. They immediately come back to Jerusalem and tell the others, we've seen Jesus, because they did. They saw him on the road to Emmaus. They also saw him when he broke the bread. So they're like, we've seen Jesus, you know. And they're like, he's not alive. I'm going to believe it. You know, what are you talking about? And while they're while they're talking about whether Jesus was alive or not, it says, and as they were talking about these things, Jesus showed up. This is great. This is on Sunday. This is all taking place on Sunday. We've had the events of Friday. I'm taking us back now to the scriptures. And we've had the events of Friday, the crucifixion. And they're all, the disciples are all disillusioned and upset. And they're all, they're afraid for their lives, thinking the Romans are going to come after them next. And the religious leaders know who they are. And they crucified Christ. Now they're all, they're going to come after them next. So they're all huddled down. And these two guys that had been, who left Jerusalem, come back from Emmaus, and they, we've seen him. And then Jesus shows up in the room, and they were talking. Well, while they were talking, Jesus comes, and what does he say to them? This is so good, this is so rich. Peace to you, right? Peace to you. Peace to you. Here's the resurrected Lord in front of these scared disciples who are hiding out from the authorities, who are disillusioned and sad, and he says, peace to you. We need peace. You need peace in your life today? Calm, serenity. You know, what do you need to know when it comes to peace? You need to know that your stuff, your sins, your background, your mistakes, your failures, that stuff is before God, taken care of. You know, it might not be before other people, but we just have that sense that God's given us inside of a compass of right and wrong. We know we've failed. We know we've fallen short. You have to have peace with yourself. You have to know that you're forgiven. And Jesus came to do that. And his resurrection is the assurance that what he did on Friday was sufficient, acceptable payment. He came out of the grave. You really can know for sure that what Christ did for you really did pay for all the stuff, all the sins, all the mistakes. Peace, he says. You never have, somebody said this, you never have peace with yourself till you, or peace with other people until you know peace with God. Do you have peace with God? Do you? On what basis? If you say to me, on the basis that Christ died for me and I've received his mercy and grace and I've come to him, I have peace with God through the cross. There's no peace with God except through the cross. In other words, he paid it, I received it, and now I know my sins are forgiven, I have peace with God. What separates us from God? Sin. Sin separates us from God. That's why Adam and Eve, you know, they went out of the garden. They left the garden, driven out. They didn't know God. That's why our world today doesn't know God. Sin's removed, you come back into a relationship with God. The Bible says you get reconciled to God through the cross. And so, peace. Peace be to you. Such a rich phrase. How about peace with your own death? Afraid to die? So many people afraid to die. When you know that Jesus Christ has forgiven you and he's risen from the dead and has gone to prepare a place for you and will come and get you and take you to be where he is, what's there to fear in death? It's entrance into life. My brother, who died a few weeks ago, knew the Lord, loved the Lord. He served our church, you know, for almost 30 years, doing everything. I just loved, a lot of you knew my brother Scott. And, you know, so my wife and I took him meals over the month that he, before he died. And we'd go over there and enjoy a meal together. And he told me how much he looked forward to being with the Lord. And he hoped that his ALS wasn't prolonged, that he could kind of get there. And I said, well, you're going to miss a really great political year. And he laughed. And he said this to me, I can't wait to get out of here. See, peace with death, because you know the Lord Jesus Christ is preparing a place for us. He's going to come again, you know. Scripture teaches that everywhere. He's coming again. Not to die on a cross, not to be born in a manger, not to be the Savior of the world. He's already done that. We're reflecting on what Christ has already done. When he comes again, it's his triumphal king. It's to gather those who have put their faith in him, to gather them to meet him in the air, and then enjoy the kingdom of God being prepared now. You enter the kingdom of God, you become a part of it through Jesus Christ, through your faith in him. He's your only hope. He's your only salvation. He's your only peace. God loves you even while you were an enemy, and I was an enemy. He loved you, and Christ died for you. Come to him. Be reconciled to God. Confess your sins so that you might be forgiven and take part in it. Peace I give to you. And he said to them, why are you troubled? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? See my hands and feet, that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a spirit doesn't have flesh and bones, as you see that I have. What's Christ doing? He appears in the room. He appears in the room, and they're sort of still in amazement, right? And he says, guys, essentially, I'm not a spirit, you know. You need to touch me. A spirit doesn't have hands and feet like I have. See, that's sort of that would be your, you know, if somebody who had died, I hate to use my brother as an example because I don't want to mess that up. But I mean, if he just sort of appeared in our bedroom after he's died, you know what I'm saying? I mean, we'd be like, what was this? It's a demon. I mean, it's a ghost. What is this? We'd be terrified. That's what's happening to the disciples after the resurrection, is Jesus appears in the room and they're like, we're seeing a ghost. All right, so Jesus is like, you know, hey, calm down, man. It's me, okay? It's me, look at me, it's me, see? It's me, it's really me. Put your hands here, see the holes here, touch them. See the feet, it's really me. The resurrection of Jesus Christ is the body that went into the grave is the body that came out. It was a bodily resurrection. He actually rose from the dead. I mean, there are some who don't believe the accounting of the scripture, and they don't believe that miracles truly could ever happen. They don't believe that people rise from the dead. That's impossible. Science proves it. Rationalism, rational thinking, logic, and philosophy prove it. People don't rise from the dead. There aren't miracles to show them that Jesus didn't. This wasn't a spiritual thing like some people would want us to believe. That the resurrection is more like an idea. It's an encouraging thought. And that's what inspired those early followers to spread the word. It's like positivism. The spirit, it's like Easter time, spring, new flowers, birds, things are springing up. That's what the resurrection is. It's a spirit of resurrection, of new life, and all of that. The resurrection of Jesus Christ is a bodily resurrection. He came out. It's not an idea. It's an actual fact. So what does that mean for us? It means everything that Jesus said about himself is true. He is truly the Son of God. He is the second person in the Trinity, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. He is the second person who came into this world and claimed to be the Son of God. And because he came out bodily and he was resurrected from the dead, his claims are true. And peace be with you. The scripture teaches that we too, at Christ's second coming now, will be raised. And how will you be raised? You'll be raised bodily. I'll talk to you more about that in the next series on 1 Corinthians 15. You know, you're not raised a spirit. Who wants to be unclothed? People have this idea we're raised like spirit beings floating around somewhere. You know, it's in the movies. That's not in scripture. You are raised with a resurrection body, but it's the same body reconstituted by God. Will you be recognized in heaven? Yes, yes. We'll know you. You have the same personality, the same, have the same voice inflection. It'll be a new body that God makes. It's like these bodies, you know, are the cells are always turning over and changing. You know, like all the cells of the body are being renewed. And probably you're looking at my body, but you're looking at new cells. I would hate to show you the ones from 20 years ago. Those are gone. They died off. They're renewed. Your body in heaven will be a new body, but it'll be a body. It'll be you. And you'll be recognized. This is why Jesus' emphasis on touch me and all is to encourage you with what the new resurrection is. And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and feet. And while they were still in disbelief for joy and were marveling, he said to them, have you guys got anything here to eat? They gave him a piece of boiled fish, and he took it, and he ate it before them. Can I say it again to you that the resurrection of Jesus Christ was this a bodily resurrection, the same body that went in dead to the tomb? Crucified Savior went in dead, was raised on the third day alive, that same body, different change, resurrection body. It's the proof of everything. Either the scriptural record is true or it's a lie. Some say maybe they hallucinated all this. I'll show you in the next series how Jesus, after his resurrection, appeared to more than 500 people at one time. Say, well, how could the resurrection happen? We'll look into that in the next series. You've got to be convinced of this. As a Christian, you need to be absolutely convinced of this so that you have the hope that God wants you to have, the peace he wants you to have. And if you're not a Christian, you must deal. If you're not a believer, you must deal with the fact of the resurrection. That book that we mentioned that's being passed around, you can get one. Read it. If Jesus truly rose from the dead, then he is who he said he is. And your whole eternity lies in the balance. If you don't consider him or reject him, your whole eternity. Because after all, we all will face the greatest enemy, death. And you have no idea when. But you need to get yourself ready by coming to Christ, who's the only one who's conquered it. He conquered it. Think of it. No wonder you can have peace in knowing that. Let's pray together. Lord, we come to you now. Thank you for the resurrection, Jesus from the dead. Bodily resurrection. And if you're here today, I want to give you that opportunity to place your faith in the resurrected Lord. What does that mean? It means placing your faith in him and not in yourself. Don't trust your own works. Don't trust your own goodness. Don't trust your own acts to get yourself in a right relationship with God. Trust Jesus. He died for you to forgive you. He died for you. Confess your sins. Oh, Lord, say to him, this is you. Oh, Lord, I confess my sins to you. I know I fall short. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for dying on a cross for me to pay the penalty of my sins. I receive you as my Savior, my Lord. I want to experience the final resurrection when you come again, my resurrection. And I want to live in the power of your presence now. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. If you prayed with me today and feel like, you know, I think I get it. I think I understand it. And I'd love to communicate with you. Put the number on the screen. See that number there? That's our sort of all-purpose number, when I say it that way. You can text anything to that, and one of our staff will get it. And what I'd like you to text to that number is just, today, if it's different for you, I guess that's the way I'm going to explain it. I know many here are believers, right? Praising God. But some of you here are just, it's all new to you. But maybe something happened in your heart today. I'm not talking emotional. I'm talking about, well, it could be emotional, but something sort of, the light went on. Anybody here have an aha moment? Tell me. Like, aha, this is real. You know, aha, God really does exist. Aha, I am a sinner. Aha, Jesus saves me. Whatever, let us know. We want to follow up. We want to encourage you. We want to help you to grow, understand what Jesus did, and even further. So, and then you can just say hi if you want to. Okay? That number's there for you. I want to invite the offering team to come down, and we'll receive an offering today. We do receive offerings at the end of all of our services. And we do it as an opportunity to worship God, to praise God, thank God. If you're new, and there are a lot of people that are new today, you're visiting, right? You're here. Please just let the bucket go by. We don't want you to feel any sort of like, you know, pressure to give it all. This is for the family of God that calls Spring Hills home, their home church, all right? So please be our guests and just pass it on by. Lord, thank you for the opportunity to give to you, to praise you. And how could we possibly return anything that would in any way parallel what you have done for us in coming into this world, dying for us, and rising again? We love you in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen.
Go ahead, stand up, and let's praise God together.
There's a song in my spirit. There's a joy in my soul. What a will, what a name. I'll worship anyway. Or the devil can try it. Try to quiet this song, and I sing out even louder. I'm gonna give him everything. I'm gonna shout.
psych is like a daily medication. I try, but I can't change my situation. Cause they're like,